Jehovah, Jesus Christ, Holy Michael. God, once again, we thank you for making it possible for us to be here today. Lord, accept our thanks. The time has come for us to go into your word. In the name of Jesus, your children are expecting to hear from you. Lord, descend into me and speak yourself out today. The word of salvation is what we are expecting. What does it profit the man? He began the Lord's work and loses his soul. In Jesus Christ's name, one or two that we are going to say this afternoon, let it lead us into salvation.
Amen.
Regarding the person that is going to speak, you are the only one that can purify him. I pray in the name of Jesus, descend into me and purify me.
Amen.
Empty my heart and fill it with your Holy Spirit.
Amen.
To those that are going to hear, Lord Emmanuel, let them hear to your salvation.
Amen.
I thank you for hearing our prayer.
Thank you, Lord.
Jesus Christ's name I pray.
Amen.
That's your only.
prayer. We welcome ourselves to another day of the Lord, the day that the Lord has made, in which we are rejoicing and we are glad in it. May the joy and blessing of today be able to remain with us forever.
Amen.
I'm still going to bother you a bit. I will want the choir to please help me render this song again. Oh, yeah, God, where? Oh, yeah, God, where? The first day of the month to be Sunday. It is not by coincidence, but because God wants it to be so. Today is the first day of July, the seventh day, the seventh month of this year, 2018. It's not an ordinary day. If you take it to be an ordinary day, then it's left for you. But you believe that God is going to do something miraculous in your life today, then it is time for you to actually open your mouth and tell God what you want from Him this month. Can we pray?
Again,
Then after glorifying God, after giving homage to God, he said to his people, oh, I am Nebuchadnezzar. I made this. I made that. Look at my dominion. Look at how good my kingdom is. My kingdom is endure forever. And then God looked at him. He then sent an entourage to Jerusalem. Go and kidnap all the people. Go and fight the people in Jerusalem. Then kidnap all of them. And people, the knowledgeable people in the king's palace, bring them to my house and bring them to my kingdom. And when this thing was done, the Babylonians went to Jerusalem. They fought them. They conquered them. And then they took four people from the land of from the king's palace. The four people we know, and these are Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And the fourth one is Daniel. He took them. These are king queen's council. And then when we refer to our learned person here, we said, yeah, we have lawyer, we have barrister. And when we have barrister with an appellation, QC. QC means queen's council. These are the people that advise the queen. And as it was today, so also it was then. People that were advising the king in Jerusalem, after conquering them, he asked them to take them and bring them to his palace. And when they bring them to his palace, he was nurturing them because he wanted to actually extract the knowledge that they were using to develop Israel from them. But as God will have it, because he didn't respect God, because he think the position he was, he worked for it. And when we are saying this, I want us to be putting ourselves in the position of Nebuchadnezzar, because you and I are no better than him. The moment that we are in a position, if we are actually looking for employment or we want to go for an interview next week, we are ready to spend 7-9 vigil in this church, praying every day for that interview to come to pass. Am I lying? Now the moment we got that job and we are there, yes, we are now the manager. Now God has established us. Now we think, oh yes, this position that I am now. I remember when I used to do this or do that. Now I am the king here. I am the overall boss. I said to this, go, and they go. I said to that, come, and they come. If I want to sack anybody, I have the authority to sack them. If I want to promote, I have the right to promote. And then we forget what we did before we actually got that job. At the moment we do that, rather than continue to give glory to God, that Lord, I thank you again today that you still allow me to be in this seat. We give adoration to what we have achieved. Oh, I am a PhD, or I've done my BSc, or I've done my PhD, this and that. And it was that one that actually put you in that position. No, a lot of people have got their BSc, and they are doing Okada driver in Nigeria. Am I lying? This is the issue, is that if God has put you in a position, give glory to God. And this is exactly what Nebuchadnezzar did. No, when we hear in Nebuchadnezzar, that is 300 years, 1,000 ago, or whatever. No, when we are hearing all these things, let us continue to look at them and put our name there and see, how do we actually measure up to the standard that God expects us to do, or are we also in the line of Nebuchadnezzar? The good thing about Nebuchadnezzar is that he forsake God, and God showed him his power. He said, yes, because you have forsaken me, this and this is what is going to happen. He didn't actually send prophet or prophetesses to him. He actually revealed it to him in a plain language on a dream. And then when he had the dream, he was not able to interpret the dream. When he wasn't able to interpret the dream, he sought for counsel from those people that are advising him. They couldn't interpret the dream. Then somebody pointed out that there is somebody who is not even from us here, who is Daniel. He's a learned person, or he's a knowledgeable person, and we believe that God is using him. He can interpret the dream. And God called on Daniel to come. The king called on Daniel to interpret the dream. When Daniel had the dream, he didn't give the interpretation immediately. He said God should give him, and the king should give him some time to reason. Again, this is a lesson from us. When somebody tells you something, If you don't know the answer to it, please rather than for you to jump from here to here, or for you to do a try and error. Let me say this or that. If God didn't ask you to say, can you tell the person, I've heard what you say. Ma, I've heard what you say, sir. Can I go and think about it and come back to you? That should be the reply of a knowledgeable or somebody that is God-fearing. And when you hear that, you go into your bosom and say, Mr. A has told me something. These things that are happening in the old, they are happening every day. A sister of yours or a daughter of yours came to you and wrote to you and said, hey, Father, this is my problem. I don't know what to do. Brothers, oh yes, yes, you should do it this way, No. Tell him or her, okay, let me sleep over it. Let me think about it. I'll come back to you. In another day or two, I pray to God for God to reveal what you are going to say to him or her to you. So that you will not mislead the person that is listening that wanted something from you. It is very important. So Daniel went into his bosom and he told God, God, you are the one that has the knowledge of everything. There is nothing hidden before you. Because you can see during the light and you can also see through the darkness. You can see on the earth, you are in heaven, and you can even see something that is under the ground. Can you please glorify yourself by revealing the meaning of this dream unto me? And God hearkened unto Daniel. He revealed the true story and the true meaning of the dream to him. And Daniel went back to the king and said, King, this dream that you have told me, I will pray that may it be to your enemy and not to you. Then the king said, what do you mean? Say what God has told you. And okay, if you want me to continue, then Daniel revealed the message to him. Basically, that God is going to punish Nebuchadnezzar for not acknowledging the power of God. And that God is going to change his counsel into the that of the beast. So he will be behaving like the beast. And then he will go into the field. He's going to stay in the field for 7 years, eating grass. Imagine somebody that is in the palace. God asked him. God didn't want to kill him. God can strike him dead there. But he wants his glory to show to the world. Because in some places, when we are praying, oh my enemy, anywhere you are now, I want you dead. If the enemy is dead, the dead is dead. Whether the good dead or bad dead, is dead. But if you want the glory of God to be revealed, you ask God, whoever is disturbing my progress, expose him or her, so that the world will glorify your name through it. I mean, that should be our prayer. If you do that, then wherever your enemy is he or she that will actually say, do you know for 3 years I've been debating the progress of Mr. A or Mrs. B, and God has now told me to go and tell the world that I have been the person disturbing the progress. And now the time has come for the glory of God to show. Then people of God, the people around will say, ha, you minister or you mother, how can you do this? Then they will be glorifying the name of God. Do we understand? So Daniel revealed the true meaning of the dream to Nebuchadnezzar, and immediately Nebuchadnezzar's counsel turned from that of human being to a beast, and he crawled into the field, and he was there for 7 years. During these 7 years, imagine a human being eating grass only for 7 years. It's not an easy thing. Yes, if you want to diet, then we ask you to go for grain. Going for grain is not going to eat grass. Eating grass is different from eating grains, and we should know the difference. The grass is meant for the animal, for the beast. And for a human being to be on the field for 7 years eating grass and living there with animal is not a joke. It's more than being in the prison. The Lord called the dew of heaven to fall on him. See, it's not the rain that is enjoying. It's enjoying the dew of heaven. And he did that for 7 years. And after the seventh year, according to the word of God, God called him back And he said, now the 7 years has passed. I now restore you back, and I now restore your cancer back to a human being. Are you now going to acknowledge me or not? And he said, hallelujah to heaven, and to God in heaven, and to Jesus Christ. He said, yes, I now acknowledge that you are God. You are the God of everything, and you are able to do and undo. I acknowledge your name on everything, and I will worship you from now on until the death of my life. And God said, okay, because you have repented, I will restore you back into your position. And God restored him back to his kingship position. And all those people that are working for him, with him, are working with him, and then everything comes back to normal. It's a very good story that people would like to listen to, but like I said earlier, what lesson do we want to learn from it? That thing that you have, that palace that you are living on, that fat salary that you are earning, the position that you are occupying, do you give glory to God, or you think it is by your strength or by your power? We should learn from this. If you have not been doing it before, the time has now come for you and I to think and say that anything that I have, anything that I may be, whatever I want to be, is only through the grace of God, not through my power and not through my mind. May God give us the power and the wisdom to continue to acknowledge Him.
Amen.
While we are doing this, it is very important for us to acknowledge God and for us to know that our time is limited on this earth. As a matter of fact, all of us are in a journey. We have been born, and whether we like it or not, we are going to die. When we are going to die is what we do not know. But I can assure you that one thing that is common among all of us, every one of us has got it. You might not have it physically, but spiritually, it's there for you. We have all got our confirmed return ticket. What do I mean? Confirmed return ticket. And somebody has paid for it. So that you don't need to bother about it. That, until when I got reached to a certain level and I'm able to pay for my flight back to Nigeria, that is when they will send me back to Nigeria. No, they are not sending you back to Nigeria. You are not going to America. The return ticket I'm referring to is that to heaven. And the moment that you close your eyes, whether you go to heaven or you go to hell, that one depends on the mercy of God. So it depends on your hard work. But the time is still here for you. Now, at this moment, to actually change. Because God is preaching now, God is shouting through me, and He said to you that today is the day that you should change from our ways. Today is the day that we should acknowledge Him as the God Almighty. Today is the day that we should know that a day will come that we will carry our debt, we'll not be able to carry it. We want to lift our eyes up, we'll not be able to lift it up. The time is still here now. You are still here and there. Lord, accept God in totality and know that ticket that you are holding, one day you are going to use it. May God grant unto us to be able to have a repentant heart. All of us are sinned and fall short of His glory. But He is the same person that said, I have paid for this ticket, I paid for it through my blood, the blood of Jesus. It's the blood of Jesus Christ that He has used to purchase that ticket for you. But every one of us has done it. And any time that He said, your plane is ready, there's no say, I'm going back. There's no going back. Once you are checked in, from the airport, there's no way of you going back. We are here. We are here now. The time is here now for us to continue to pray. Lord, tell me, when will my time be coming? Is it next year, or is it 30 years time, or 100 years time? May God make us 100 years, but the time is very, very limited. Let us know that in anything that we do, we should acknowledge God. Remember, when we are talking, remember what happened to Nebuchadnezzar. He did not give glory to God for what God had done for him, and because of that, God punished him. May God, in His infinite mercy, have mercy on us.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
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 The title of the sermon is the fear of God. I am not starting. Don't say ah. Because anytime we are talking about the word of God, I've just said the title of my prayer is that of my sermon is the fear of God. I'm not saying, oh, I'm just starting on the first lesson. And if I do, today is a day that we're supposed to be glorifying God. May the name of God be glorified forever. Hallelujah.
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 Which are going to 2 Corinthians, which is the second lesson. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, and it's going to be from 2 Corinthians 12, 11 to 21.
I am become a fool in glory.
Yes, I have become a fool in glory.
He has compelled me.
Yes.
God said that
he has become a fool because of the people of the Corinth. This is the second time he's writing to the Corinthians. Remember, his first time he went through that place, he was planting churches like we are planting today. And the second time, he plant churches and put people there to be running it. And then he educated them on the words of God. And when he got there the second time to see how the church is doing, then there are some people that are saying, oh, maybe as well, people are dropping today, we want to see signs. Is this Paul even a part of the apostle? He didn't see Christ, as we know the story of Paul, that is not one of the 12 apostles. Oh, we need to see signs. The people of the apostle, they performed miracles. They have power. Are we sure that we are following the right person or something like that? Then Paul was saying, telling them that they are making to be fool. I mean, in order for them to understand the mystery of God. God is a mystery. I'm happy. It was mentioned this morning in the Bible our Bible class Sunday morning Bible class. The mystery of God, nobody can say they know it except His Son Jesus Christ. The mystery of God, which has been explained, is the plan of God. God doesn't reveal His plan to anybody except those people that He chose and He wants to reveal it unto. But the only person that knows the plan of His Father is Jesus Christ. Because He said, everything that my Father has, I have it. Everything that He's thinking, I can understand it. Anything that He asked me to do, that is what I do. That is what Jesus Christ said unto us. Then Jesus Christ Himself is a mystery. Nobody understands Jesus Christ. When you ask Him, when you expect Him to act, that is when He will be laughing. When you expect Him to be crying, that is when He will be laughing. When you expect Him to be laughing, that is when He will be serious. So they don't understand Him. Then no wonder He called on one of His apostles. He said, has it been that you have been with me for all this long and you still don't understand me? It was in the Bible. Nobody understands Christ. Then, again, the mystery of Christ can only be understood by the word of Christ, which is the Bible and the Holy Spirit. If He doesn't reveal His mystery unto you, you cannot understand Him. This is different from mathematics, different from 2 plus 2 equals 4. There's no formula to it. If God wants to reveal Himself unto you, it doesn't matter whether you are poor or you are in need. God will reveal Himself unto you. And that takes me to Psalm 23, which is the Lord is my shepherd. Can we read it?
The Lord is my shepherd.
Yes, please.
I shall not want.
Yes.
He makes me to lie down in green pastures.
Yes.
He leads me beside the still waters.
Yes.
He restores my soul.
Yes.
He led me in path of righteousness for His name's sake.
Yes.
Yet though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death,
yes,
I will fear no evil.
Yes.
For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me.
Yes.
Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over.
Yes.
Surely.
Hallelujah.
Surely,
yes.
Goodness and mercy,
yes.
Shall follow us,
yes.
All the days of our life,
yes.
And we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Amen. That psalm is a powerful psalm. Every word of God is powerful. Everything that is written in the Bible is powerful. When you are talking about Psalm, the Psalm 23 is the Psalm that most of us will easily get understand or get memorized in those days. Everybody, maybe in the whole Sunday school should know the Lord is my shepherd. We know it often. But it is a powerful Psalm that people have to read possibly every day. And when you actually read it and you believe in it, believing in what God is doing, then you know that wherever you go, whatever is going to happen, you have nobody to fear except God. Because it's the one that says that those that live in us is greater than those that are living in the world. That if you believe that Jesus Christ is living in you, if you haven't believed before, today is the day that you have to believe. And don't believe halfly. You have to believe in totality that Jesus Christ is living in you and you are living in him. And if you have that conviction, then anything that anybody might be planning against you, you know that they are going to come into naught. The moment you have Christ with you, you have got majority. As we go along, I pray that the Spirit of God will convict us and will make us his. So that because we believe in this Jesus Christ, his name, his glory, his blood, we continue to show up and the way. May God continue to enlighten us. My sister, you were reading the 2 Corinthians. Yes, please, can we continue? Yes. Very much. If you wait, what Paul is just telling, why are you worried? Why are you worried about my statue or my position? I am not working for you. I am working for Jesus Christ. I'm working for the Lord that I know. God that has revealed himself unto me. I do not want to know what you think about me. It's not what you think about me that matter. It's what God thinks about me. And many of us today, when we are doing the God's work, is he the only one? Is he the only one? Why don't you put yourself forward? If you are ready to do God's work, please do not hesitate. Go to the blind people, go to the chairman, go to the shepherd, go to the elders. Tell people. Like next year now. If you are ready, if you are willing to be the chairman for the harvest, make yourself available. I volunteer to be the chairman for next year. I want to do it from my heart. It doesn't matter your status. It doesn't matter your position. It's God that's given it to you. Everybody will support you. But if you get there and they say, oh no, you are too short, or because you are too long, you cannot do it, then that is when you complain. But if you haven't done that, please stop complaining. Your Paul was very bitter with the people of Corinth. Why are you judging me? I am this, and you didn't do that. Right? Is there anything that I've done for you? Is there, I may be crafty, but have I actually come to steal money from you or taking things that doesn't belong to me? He said, Father, it's Father that provide for the kids. It's not kids that provide for their parents. Father look after the kids. It's not the children and the kids that look after their parents. He said, it's Father that is looking after him. Then when he go forward, he was saying that, I sent Titus to you. Titus was my representative here. Has he stolen from you? He didn't do anything that is not within the line with what God asked us to do. Why are you complaining? Stop complaining. Concentrate on your God. Believe in the God that we are worshiping. I know the God that I'm worshiping. If you don't know the God you are worshiping, this is the time for you to actually know the God that you are worshiping. Let us read on. Yes.
Yes. I desire thy presence. I sent the Lord. The answers may be gained on you. Walk we not in the same spirit? Walk we not in the same steps? Again, think ye that we can use ourselves.
Go!
We speak before God in Christ. For we hold things. Then we will be edified. For I fear, lest when I come, I shall not find you such as I will, and that I shall be found unto you, such as ye will not. Lest there be babes, envy, wrath, strife, backbiting, whispering, swearing, smoke. And lest when I come again, my God will humble me out of you, and that I shall prevail. Many which have sinned already, and have not repented of their offenses, and drawn the vision, and have put themselves into the hands of God.
Thank you very much. What God is trying to say to us here today is that those of us that believe in Jesus Christ, we should believe in Him and Him only, and stop judging or looking at what A or B is doing. We've said it time without number that God is irrespecter of people. God doesn't judge you for what you own or what where the position that you are holding. He judges you as an individual. The issue is that if you are looking at Mr. A or Mrs. B, okay, these are the leader, these are the leader. Who asked you to judge them? You are not supposed to judge them. Can you please mind your business? And I'm saying it to us today. It is very, very important. We are saying that we pray and our prayer didn't answer. Have you been minding your business? Or you are minding the business of Mr. A or Mrs. B? If you are not able to build, please, can you stop destroying? And God is actually saying this. We might be saying it. We might be hearing it now. What is that boy saying? Nobody has sent me here. I haven't been here for the past week. The issue is that God is speaking to you now. That what is actually disturbing your prayer, or what is disturbing my prayer, is this ability of judging Mr. A or judging Mrs. B. Will you let God judge them? Will you let them do whatever they want to do? Okay, they want to show up. Let them show up. If it is the will of God for them to show up, let them continue. It's not everybody that can behave in the same way. But the most important thing to you is that will my name be written in that book of salvation? I am trying all I can to make heaven. I don't know about you. And every other thing doesn't really matter. It's not the money that you have here. It's not the position or the way people are saying here, hello, or this and that. No matter how many churches you build here, it's not going to take you to heaven. What is going to take you to heaven is the ability to believe totally in God, to love God with all your heart, and to do His way. And as I pray that as we believe in here today, God will impart His knowledge into us so that anywhere that we are, we will not be looking at Mr. A or Mr. B, but we will be looking at Christ as our Lord and Savior. May God continue to be with us.
Amen.